Okay, I think we'll get started. Fantastic turnout, very excited to see so many people here. I'm just going to just welcome people and make a few introductory remarks and introduce our panelists and give you some indication of how the evening will proceed. So welcome to tonight's panel discussion about the 14th International Architecture Exhibition of the Venice Biennale, a long duration and, as you know, multifaceted event directed by Rem Koolhaas, which opened in early June and continues for almost another month. I'm Felicity Scott, and along with my colleague, Marco Suda, I direct the program in critical, curatorial, and conceptual practices in architecture, the CCCP program, which is the institutional host of tonight's discussion. So I wanted to actually begin by saying that the idea for tonight's panel emerged, in fact, out of a conversation with Barry Bergdoll, one of our speakers, in mid-June, during which he pointed out the potential for a New York-based conversation about the Biennale, given both the large number of people who had attended, exhibited, or participated in various ways. Indeed, Venice, we might say, became a bit of a New York outpost during the opening, something we might well address this evening. So we clearly couldn't invite all those people, some of whom are here in the audience and might well be wondering why they too are not at the table this evening. I think the opportunity to open up a space for discussion and to solicit responses or really reflections upon this much anticipated and quite remarkable Biennale seemed very important to us to harness. And doubly so, we might say, in the context of an academic program dedicated to questions of exhibitions, of curating, research, criticism, and publications, all of course key to the apparatus of something like a Biennale, and all approached in a particular way by Koolhaas and his team. So we decided to invite a small group who, from various critical, professional, and institutional positions and with various relations to the Biennale itself, might be able to help launch this conversation, again, to table their insights and reflections and set the stage for a larger conversation. So moreover, the 14th Biennale has already been under observation, so to speak, by CCCP students themselves, following an initiative launched last spring by Augustine Shang, Martin Wood, and Javier Anton that turned into a program-wide research project in Venice during the month of June, more on which will be presented right after I finish by Caitlin Blanchfield through the lens of a publication venture that's currently in the works here at GSAPP. So I'm going to offer just like 3 minutes sort of setting out some of the key conceits very briefly and the structure. Biennale Foundation President Paolo Baratta opened his foreword to the catalog by stating, and I quote, "With Rem Koolhaas, we have created a major Biennale that researches architecture. In other words, he stressed not the exhibition, the objects of display, and its vehicles of presentation or dissemination, but the forms of examination or knowledges that it might have produced." So Koolhaas himself announces the staging of his departure from precedent somewhat differently, noting, and I quote, "After several architecture biennales dedicated to the celebration of the contemporary, Fundamentals looks at histories, tries to reconstruct how architecture finds itself in its current situation, and speculates on its future. The subtitle further underscored what was at stake in this polemical shift of focus away from the contemporary, taking the formulation of architecture, not architects, famously, notoriously, we might say. So as Koolhaas explained additionally, 34 years after the first architecture biennale, Portoghese's Presence of the Past, in which Koolhaas participated, he agreed to curate its 14th installment on a couple of conditions, one of which was that, and I quote, he would sever all connections with contemporary architecture so that I would be free to look at histories, to explore and illuminate architecture's current impasse. So what that severing looked like, how it functioned, what effects it might have had, which archives came to the fore, are all still being debated, raising many important questions regarding architecture's relation to research and practice, history and the contemporary, et cetera. So just to briefly recall the three main sections, for those who didn't get a chance to visit, very telegraphically here. Firstly, national participation in the Giardini pavilions and beyond was coordinated and took place under the title Absorbing Modernity, 1914 to 2014, individual national contributions then being recast as what he called heterogeneous portraits of a terrifying century and high Kohlhaas rhetoric, a portrait facilitating variegated, or in Kohlhaas's words, splintering stories of architecture's relationship to modernity that attempted to complicate master narratives of globalization as a homogenizing force. Secondly, the Central Pavilion exhibition served as an occasion to look at the so-called elements of architectures, doors, walls, ceilings, floors, to look at them, as Kohlhaas explained, under a microscope, within a global framework and across many temporal structures, ancient, past, current, and future, with the prospect that, and I quote, unsuspected histories and qualities emerge. And third and finally, the Arsenale served as a platform for the Mondottaglia exhibition, directed by one of our speakers, Ippolito Pestellini, and aiming to scan the current state of Italy as an emblematic condition for a global situation, but really an exhibition staged as an encounter with cinema, dance, theater, and music. So each of these three sections points to numerous concerns within the discipline and discourse of architecture. It's also important, I think, to recall that beyond being a reflection on the discipline, the Biennale is also a means of taking stock, stock of exhibitions and of curatorial practice, and of course, architectural publishing and events, forms of architectural practice to which it contributed in numerous ways. So the format tonight, very straightforward. First, I'm going to introduce the speakers, then hand the podium over to Caitlin Blanchfield, who graduated from the CCCP program last year and is currently working in the GSAPP Publications Office under James Graham. Then each of the speakers will talk very briefly for 5 minutes here at the podium so we can all have access to the images. And they've been asked very simply to make reflections on the Biennale. And then Mark Wasiuta will offer some opening remarks and questions as we convene at the table. So I decided not to introduce the speakers in any detail, that would take all evening, but just to identify briefly an affiliation or two for each of them. Barry Bergdoll, our colleague from the Art and Archaeology Department, we're very pleased actually to have recently stolen him back from MoMA, where he was chief curator of architecture and design for 7 years, and we're all eagerly awaiting his Latin America in Construction exhibition, which opens next March. After Barry will be Keller Easterling, a longtime friend of the CCCP program. She's a professor at Yale, someone from whom we've learned so much, not only about architecture, but also about urbanism and geopolitical conflicts, whether through her writings, her exhibitions, and various digital initiatives. And her book, Extra Statecraft, The Powers of Matrix Space, is due any day from Verso. Third, important, insightful critic of both art and architecture, Hal Foster, usually hails from Princeton, but he's currently a fellow at the New York Public Library's Coleman Center. In addition to his own extensive writing, he's an editor of October Magazine and a co-founder of Zone. Beatrice Galilee, after Hal. She's, again, a critic, a curator, editor, and a teacher, and she's recently moved to New York from London. She's the newly appointed curator of architecture and design at the Metropolitan Museum. Welcome, Beatrice. We're very happy to have you here. I first met her when she co-curated the 2011 Gwangju Design Biennale, after which she went on to act as chief curator of the 2013 Lisbon Architecture Triennale, Closer. Last but not least, Ippolito Pestellini is a partner at AMO, or OMA, I should say, OMA, AMO, and as mentioned earlier, director of the Mondottaglia section of the current Architecture Biennale. He joined AMO in 2007 and works in the areas of design, of curating, preservation, scenography, etc. He's overseen many of the AMO collaborations with Prada, including the 24-hour museum in 2012, and the restaging of When Attitude Becomes Form, 1969, 2013, for the last Venice Art Biennale. So again, I'm going to hand it over to Caitlin, who's right here, and then we'll just have the speakers come up in alphabetical order.
So this past June, the program in critical, curatorial, and conceptual practices in architecture observed the Venice Biennale. A month-long research initiative, the Venice Observatory sought to investigate the production of an architectural biennial across time, scales of time and geography, employing diverse media and methods. The researchers envisioned a panoply of projects that indexed the frenetic intellectual and social activity dispersed throughout the city, the results of which would ultimately comprise a counter catalog for the biennial. The observatory then began as a provocation, one that would not simply question the stakes of this year's curatorial claims, but also turn its proverbial telescope on modes of architectural research. What emerged from the month spent in our gallery turned event space, retreat, and impromptu book club was a rich constellation of investigations and engagements, from projects that questioned authorship and national identity through close readings of single pavilions, to ones that explored shifts in national representation across the history of the Venice Biennial. Equally fertile were our transgressions of observational remove, small insertions into the hubbub of lectures, parties, and collateral events. What could we, as semi-outsiders, hamstrung for time and resources, offer to the spectacle of the Biennale and the conversations that it generated? Was precisely the free-floating nature of our operation, affiliated with GSAPP, but not official emissaries of the school, connected to various pavilions, but not representatives of any country, that enabled interpositions that were responsive, flexible, and not overburdened by institutional seriousness. Bika Rebeck's intervention, Interspace, questioned the disciplinary divides and communicative potential of the different biennales, pushing the collaborative conceit of Mondatalia beyond the Arsenale. Bika invited Laura Morrow, a dancer rehearsing in Mondatalia, to the Estonian Pavilion. Over the course of an hour, her improvised performance manipulated the boundaries of the installation by asking participants to interact with the space in unintended and at times uncomfortable ways. It created, as Rebeck said, a dialogue with the grid, here representative of modernity and computer technology in the Estonian context, rather than following a prescribed way of interacting with it. Augustin Shang had a chance encounter with a book. If London Were Like Venice is a speculative treatise that projects the built environment of London after the Thames has breached its banks. Published in 1899, it's a richly illustrated and delightfully fanciful volume. The shores of Lago de Hyde are the promenades of the landed gentry. Gondoliers navigate the Canal Regente. For Shang, the book was an allegory for Italian nationalism and the global encounter, which culminates in a critique of Mondatalia. There, according to Shang, the Arsenale is presented as an ideal set to combine the Italian geopolitical context with the case studies from the other biennales, cinema, dance, music, and theater. This is an attempt to build a single narrative of the host country, understanding Italy as if it were a paradigmatic representation of the actual world. In other words, claiming as if Italy were like all. The scope of our investigations ranged from the overarching to the local, assessing the fetish value of the fundamental. Ashraf Abdallah broke down the elements of architecture. Kuhlhaas, Abdallah writes, argues the predicament of contemporary architecture lies in its ability to fully absorb the forces of technological modernization within the core of its architectural thinking, which has traditionally focused on aesthetics. Nonetheless, Kuhlhaas's technological move against aesthetic modernism led him straight to the heart of aestheticism, not away from it. Technological modernism itself is an already assumed fundamental, and embedded within this technological advance, architecture's elements themselves are branded. Alyssa Anderson read branding through an in-depth tour of the bookshop. In Discourse on Display, she examines the Fundamentals Catalog, the Elements Series, books by national pavilions, and assorted ephemera. By asking questions about these publications' content, design, authorship, production, distribution, and circulation, Anderson moves past critiquing the books themselves to developing arguments about how print publications are employed and deployed as a platform by the various actors at the Biennale. She asks, how are architects, curators, research-based practitioners, and other agents using books in conjunction with this highly visible yet ephemeral event? And what do their apparent intentions indicate about the roles of published discourse within the discipline? Our research traced the breaches of the biennial as well as its at times vexed relationship to Venetians. To analyze the incorporation of new national pavilions and anticipate future additions, Oscar Aronson imagined the role of the director of the unsolicited pavilion. As director, he wrote an open letter to the Minister of Education for the underrepresented democracy. In it, he appeals to each future national pavilion to establish a critical framework for their participation in the biennial that will ensure constituents' abilities to participate in a global forum of discourse on architecture, avoid opportunistic participation from interested parties, and free said fictive minister to claim ownership of the history and territory of the nation you represent and question some of the assumptions associated with them. Meanwhile, turning to the collateral Catalonian and Scottish pavilions, Martí Amargós asked, is there such a thing as a secessionist architecture? While Scotland's pavilion exists in physical and curatorial dialogue with the British National Pavilion, Catalonia sits far afield from the Spanish and outside the Giardini, evidence of Spain's inability to reconcile secessionist movements within a national conversation. The need to reflect secession within a landscape of national representation reverberates with particular saliency in Venice, where 90% of the population would like the Veneto to break away from Italy. Probing deeper into the biennial's relationship to its site, my own project, undertaken with Greg Barton and Max Lauder, took shape in a series of interviews with members of Rebiennale, a collective of artists and activists who repurpose discarded materials from pavilion construction. Rebiennale helps to make the biennial's presence relevant, even as it distances itself from its official operations. Working with immigration lawyers in the Veneto, they have outfitted apartments for recent immigrants to the city. Workshops with IUAV students teach the techniques of adaptive reuse, and many students live in squats scattered throughout Giudecca, Santa Marta, and Canareggio. The actors and places that house local art and politics, those that biennials are largely indifferent to, are often able to feed off of it in fascinating ways. They reinvigorate its structures, solicit new alliances between artists, architects, and curators, and force a larger ecology of use in Venice and the Veneto. The observatory space itself was also quite integral to our project. The Emily Harvey Foundation is a historic Fluxus Gallery at the foot of the Rialto Bridge. Here, through discussions and exhibitions, the aim was to open space for conversations in the spirit of, but critically engaged with, REM's official theme. We hosted collateral events, like the Salon for the Failed Architecture Group, entitled Reclaiming Modernity, which addressed the fundamentals of architecture through local articulations of modernity. In reaction to the biennial's theme and title, the group brought together pavilion curators, scholars, and architects to excavate the foundations of the modern movement from different perspectives, both disciplinarily and geographically, asking, shouldn't fundamentals also consist of the intangible principles of architecture? We were also a repository for the ephemera, flyers, and gratuitous tote bags that amounted to the Biennale's promotional apparatus and lengthy paper trail. Into this pop-up exhibition, we added the posters and pamphlets of protest movements, like the one that calling for an end for large cruise ships in the Venetian Lagoon. The Export Archive installation installed a fax machine in the gallery to transmit submissions responding to the question, what is excluded, foreclosed, or overlooked from the 2014 Venice Biennale? Dispatches from New York, Amman, Algiers, and beyond were received and pinned up over the course of this month. The project was a filter, collecting and disseminating documents, including materials and ephemera excluded from formal biennial structures. It is an ongoing question into the protocols and possibilities of network archiving, sharing, and translating. Time, clearly, was another asset. The luxury of being able to return to the Giardini over these weeks after the crowds had dissipated enabled nuanced contemplations that addressed the ongoing programming of the pavilions. Florencia Alvarez studied the Swiss summer school, successively visiting the courtyard-turned-classroom of the Swiss pavilion. Florencia traced the narratives of the performers and students in the pavilion's visiting schools program, the Stalker Walking School, Domus Academy, and Rice University. Each of the schools spent a week at the pavilion to conduct continuing research. They left behind a new archive with the work to be used as a toolbox for subsequent scholars, opening the archive to further explorations and bringing it together with new pedagogical approaches. Florencia suggests might give a hint of the school of tomorrow and shed light on the Biennale as a pedagogical tool. Time also allowed for careful study. Based on the question, what does architecture research look like, Greg Barton's representation of research developed an index of exhibition design by diagramming over 50 national pavilions in order to see how curators and architects' installations communicated information. His abstract notation system symbolizes modes of representation such as photographs, models, drawings, audiovisuals, full-scale constructions, books and texts, and performance. The biennial provided myriad forms of architectural display. Greg's exercise acted as a barometer in surveying current trends or predilections in exhibition practice. So it was a wide-ranging and at times all-consuming month, with a rotating cast of characters, a diversity of research interests. And the question was how best to represent this work. And what I've shown here is just a portion of the many excellent projects that everyone was working on. So if the biennial catalog organizes itself on firm definitions, what is a staircase, a wall, a floor, its counter-catalog embraces the fragmented outcomes of observation and the subjectivity of the observational eye, untangling the knotted threads of critique, cultural practice, and public conversation in our forthcoming book. The pages therein will register the enthusiasm of our research and the formats through which a critical practice plays out.
Thank you for doing this, Felicity and Mark. What I'm going to say is somewhat irreverent, so probably I won't have to talk to any of you at the end. But I wanted to say that the reason that I suggested this was it was the first time that I've spent in Venice where even the party conversation, the dinners were about the exhibition. It was so compelling, so problematic in so many fascinating ways that one couldn't stop thinking about it and talking about it, and I still haven't figured out what it all means. And so this is a little bit just a romp through some disconnected thoughts. I got to start first because my name begins with a B, but I also thought as the the historian of the ancient past, I keep thinking that this flashing technique is itself a curatorial thing, and it's going to deliver some kind of obscenity or counter message in the bits of type that keep appearing. So I'm going to read this, so I won't get too long. What is the status of historic research and thinking today in the first Venice Biennale in over 30 years to declare its theme as related not to the present alone, as in more ethics, less aesthetics, the people meet in architecture, common ground, etc., but instead the linked propositions of fundamentals and absorbing modernity? What is the message of, these are more questions for us to discuss than necessarily conclusions. What is the message of the Biennale in a moment as well when the star architect becomes the star curator? At once micromanaging the national pavilions as never before, and at the same time banishing any representation of contemporary architectural practice from the vast fairgrounds, converted into a convention center of historical material, some organized in timelines, some in dioramas, some in provocative visions of recent art practices. What are we to make of the return of the archive as a fascination in the era of the internet and the digital, when seemingly physical materials are more and more irrelevant and the organization of big data, even historical big data, into display seems decidedly an old paradigm, consuming of time and space when everything can be had instantaneously with a few taps, or if you've recently befriended Siri, with voice control. Where are we with the deployment of historical material in space? Perhaps one definition of the now ubiquitous gerund curating. If we compare the Venice Architectural Biennale, founded in 1980, famously under the title The Presence of the Past, with Fundamentals and Absorbing Modernity. Even if Paolo Portoghese's Strada Novissima was produced by film set designers, which is a more accurate comparison for the final exam, Paolo Portoghese's Strada Novissima was produced by film set designers from Roma's Cinecittà, and thus were meant to vanish as rapidly as they appeared. That biennial did signal an era in which the history of architecture was thought to be of enormous relevance to contemporary culture, no matter what one thought of postmodernism as it was being practiced. Coolhouse is hyper-aware of the obvious bookending between the situation in 1980 and that 34 years later. And he explains that Portoghese thought he was ushering in a sea change, which in fact, per Coolhouse, in this edition of the Biennale, can now be better understood. This is a very fascinating taking on of Portoghese, and it's very self-consciously going back to this opening moment of 1980, not so much 1914 in the very short text in the catalog, but a grappling with 1980, and if they could have known what was actually currently going on at the moment. So I'm going to, at the risk of repeating a phrase or two that Felicity already brought up, I want to read for a moment from it. The 66 nations, Coolhouse writes, throw a fundamentally different light on the so-called end of modernism that Portoghese and Charles Jenks had already proclaimed in the 1980s. At most, the postmodernism that the first biennial introduced was, he concludes, a confused footnote. Now, one wonders if we are any more able to see our own place in a larger historical sequence than were those who gathered together to create the Strada Novissima in 1980. Coolhouse goes on to explain his aims in the fat catalog of the Biennale. Books get ever fatter, of course. Previous Biennales have looked at architecture as a whole, he writes, trying to project the full picture, including context and politics. Here, we present micro-narratives, revealed by focusing systematically on the scale of the detail or the fragment. We uncover not a single unified history of architecture, but the multiple histories, origins, contaminations, similarities, and differences of those very ancient elements and how they evolved into our current iterations. Now, despite the fact that until the final phrase of this, this sounds like the introduction to almost any book in architectural history of the last generation, influenced by historians such as Carlo Ginzburg and Robert Darnton, who introduced this notion, at least in the English language, of the micro-history. All of this is brought to us under the guise of a radical novelty, as well as much of the critical reception has been under the notion of a radical novelty of a research paradigm. Now, true, we are more in the realm of a neo-modern interest in avant-garde origins than an engagement with, say, classicism of the longue durée, and that, too, is something I hope we can discuss. What kind of history is being presented at Venice? Now, I have just a few disconnected comments to help us, I hope, have a conversation about that. Perhaps no more disconnected than any biennial, I suppose, because I wonder in the end, in a space as big as Venice, and with the necessity of subcontracting in filling such a space, providing it with the content, as I suppose we would now say when places like MoMA refer to their curators as content providers, how else could we do it other than subcontracting? So first, fundamentals. And I thought by bringing in pictures for those of you who hadn't been there that it would give you some sense of the place. These are, of course, Irma Boom's graphics available in small books, big books, t-shirts, teacups, and the like, analyzed by our students. Now, first, fundamentals. Or are they elements? It keeps wavering. Now, fundamentals and elements are not the same. I think we might discuss that. I wish there had been some clarity on that perfect discussion. It leaves us, as ever, in the cool halcyon notion of not knowing whether we're being prescriptive or neutrally and ironically observatory. They are clearly not the same as they have been conceived, nor are they the same as they have been conceived of in previous treatises that have borne these titles. These are only some of them. There's a whole book room that greets you when you come in, the beginning of the notion that what you see will actually not be absorbed during the time spent there, unless you're Columbia students who have a summer in Venice. But then those were texts written by single figures, not anthologies. What happens when you anthologize? What happens when Coolhouse's notion of research becomes a franchise, which I suppose to a certain extent it already has in the countless children of REM that today are everywhere in practice and in education? Is the 2014 Venice Architectural Biennale the denouement of the Coolhousean notion of research, or a retrospective? Sometimes it seems to me that just as SOM were sometimes referred to in the 1950s as three blind mice, that there are today many tropes developed at OMA and AMO that are now stripped of their polemical clarity, or at the very least polemical irony, of Rem Koolhaas as he developed positions sparring with modernism with absolute brilliance from delirious New York to small SMLXL. Already, it seems to me, in fundamentals, we have proof that one size does not fit all. Rem's opening gesture is clear enough. Here's the overall show, and here's the opening gesture. So here we are in fundamentals in what used to be called the Italian Pavilion. Rem's opening gesture is brilliant and clear enough. Today, we don't make things over and over again, as in the Semperian notion. Rather, we assemble them from the objet type of industry. Even if the plaster ceiling above, late 19th century plaster ceiling, might be every bit as false as the drop ceiling of masonite panels hiding infrastructure. The four elements have been replaced by Sweet's catalog. There are other evocations, where the vast variety of window types collected by an extraordinary English antiquarian who I met in front of his treasures are jammed into a room with a window-making machine. But in other places, the subcontracting seems to muddy the message, as in the now notorious room devoted to the walls, or in the room devoted to stairs, where the psychological registers, rather than the standardization of the stair, seems the point. But what is the overall point? What does Rem mean to say to us about the situation of architecture in the face of these ready-mades? Is architecture as a creative practice in its end game, or is it beginning anew, as with Duchamp, another figure celebrating a centennial of modernity? Is this why the toilet is one of the fundamentals? Monde d'Italia. Here, contemporary architects are admitted to be shown as long as they show their work as curators, researchers, or as installation designers, not as architects per se. Here we can begin what I would like to propose is a typology. I'm a historian of the 19th century, so I had to make a typology of contemporary architectural display to take over tropes from recent art practices. In Monde d'Italia, the predominant ones have to do with data visualization, and along with it, with the near obsession with the timeline. There are some brilliant vignettes here, but what does it all add up to? Oops. I'm not allowed to go beyond that slide. The National Pavilions, this data visualization, and of course one of the most intriguing of the, and suggestive of all of the timelines, this one curated by Beatrice Colomina and the students at Princeton. The National Pavilions. Now, here we have something to discuss. For what is the role of the nation state in relationship to the globalizing vision of the generic that greeted us in the elements or fundamentals? Does the nation state still mean what it meant in 1914 when Europe went to war on a continental scale for the first time since the defeat of Napoleon a century earlier? Here the historian of architecture will be reveling in countless new information, and indeed I was. But the question we need to discuss is, has the shape of the narrative of modernism been altered by this extravaganza? Has the new paradigm of accumulation as research, OMA meets big data, the datascape yielding to the scanner, yielded a new history? Or even fragments of one that are begging for a new history? The most fascinating thing to me is that it is the countries with the most troubled national histories that yielded the most fascinating displays, the former components of Yugoslavia, for instance. The Netherlands revealed very predictably, that there was a social project at the heart of the work of Bakima. Here, it seems to me, we could find three tropes of recent art practices that have been taken over into the practices of architectural curating, sometimes with brilliant results. And I am saying all of this in a deliberately provocative tone of voice. I had a wonderful time. There were many wonderful things there, from details to overall pavilions. But I think that I'm going to put these into three tropes. The first, and I think in Venice the most compelling, is installation art and its variances. I'm showing you just an example of installation art, the rain room at MoMA, although I think almost every installation in this regard at Venice was far more provocative. Jean Louis in the audience, I think, fits into one that I think was more in the version of installation art. There are indeed some profound results, and ones that recognize as well that an avalanche of information often melts before it can be absorbed. The transposition of as much of the floor plan of the 1964 Sepp Roof Chancellor's Bungalow in Bonn inside the Nazi-era German pavilion is about as powerful as you can get on the subject of the iconographical stakes of modernism in the Cold War without any necessity to accumulate Xeroxes, scans, or images. And an installation that marvelously can't be sold as an art commodity since it is rendered meaningless in any other container. The plotters tracing the morphology of Palestinian and Israeli settlement into sand from the Dead Sea also operates as much as an art piece as it does a brilliant didactic architectural display. The second trope is the archive, a favorite of artists like Christian Boltanski, shown here. It was already adopted over 10 years ago, 2003, for the out-of-box show at the CCA, and of course the paradoxical notion of a living archive is a product of this very school. Here the idea of minimal editing, that everyone can learn from an archive, a historian is not needed, is taken up in some powerful shows, but ones that admit that most people will not look at any more than 10% of what is on display, as in the brilliant Korean and Japanese pavilions, both curated by graduates of OMA. The last type of my three types is the transposition of relational aesthetics into architectural curatorship, often in a form that is a hybrid with the archival trope. Here the best is the archival hospital, imagined by the Orstar curator Hans-Ulrich Obrist in the Swiss Pavilion. Obrist's installation of Lucien Burkhardt and Cedric Price in the Swiss Pavilion, now did you know that Price was Swiss, used facsimiles, perhaps a welcome relief from miles and miles of digital scans and Xeroxes at Venice at the moment. I would really, really love to know how they're holding up. Here, documents have no context except what is offered by the docents. We're on the top left here, an ultimate condemnation of all displaced techniques, I suppose. Other pavilions, like our own in the bottom right, offer a hybrid version, one in which an almost, I don't know how you make this into an adjective, Borgesian from Borges, reproduction of the archive at a one-to-one scale in hundreds of magazine articles that no one will ever read in situ, is juxtaposed with office workers whose activities can only be understood by interrupting their work. It is easy to satirize many of the fashions on display, for instance, at the moment at Venice. I began wondering, and I suppose maybe some of the students were doing this, what a timeline of timelines would look like, for instance. And I longed for an accurate account of the sheer number of them produced, even in an environment like Venice, where nothing is conducive to absorbing one of the chief products of our modern digitalized culture, the hedonistic celebration of data mining, sometimes labeled research. I'm very grateful to Mark and Felicity for organizing tonight. Perhaps if we join efforts with the audience here, we can appraise if this extravaganza puts thinking about architecture and its history of the last century in a different place, or in fact leaves us in a historical impasse. Thank you very much.
I don't need images. So thank you, Felicity and Mark. It was such a good, nourishing thing to work on for CCCP. And so because of that, rather than discuss the bit of the elements exhibit that I worked on, it seemed more relevant to the CCCP to reflect on some stubborn structural and curatorial problems of the larger Biennale. So I wanted to offer one very brief, very simple reflection. And it's almost too obvious to say that what so palpably imprints the space, what of the Biennale, what edits and shapes everything housed and uttered there, is the residual structure of, as Barry said, the residual structure of exposition, where pavilion nations are elementary particles in an international network. And so decoupled is that structure from any current global political reality that it's sometimes, for me, even hard to take the whole assemblage seriously in past biennales. In past biennales, one's often been left wondering, you know, if all those architects and indentured interns just really wanted to get together for some kind of party or something, or since the structure of architecture practice has changed even less than the supposedly durable nation state, maybe everyone's really at home in the anachronistic structure of the space. You know, there's even, I just learned, a self-appointed Masonic or Bohemian grove-like cabal called the Dark Side that gathers to critique each Biennale. So maybe for many Biennales and many of the participants, looking down the axis at the British Pavilion with half-closed eyes, the historical aspirations of empire perfectly map onto the pavilion boutiques featuring the feverish ambitions of architecture careers. But for most of us, the structure is so clearly, loudly disallows information and evidence about a world in which nations and architecture careers are not elementary particles. So much so that sometimes one can barely focus on any particular show for all the information fallout between shows, information canceling. So if a curator designs not content, but a disposition within which information and evidence can flourish, in Kuhlhaus's curatorial structure, the pavilions arguably do share an intention that seems to allow information to flow between them. And the claim about modernism, which was obviously not entirely true, also got the pavilions talking, if only to qualify or to insist on other declensions of modernism, modernity. And many expressed relief at a break from career competitions, and perhaps unforeseen, many nations, the overwhelming thing one saw was that many nations mostly wanted to tell stories about violence and concentrations of authoritarian power for which modern architecture was only a prop in the 20th century. Even stories of violence in the overweening, overbearing management ease of Pax Americana that we saw in the U.S. pavilion. And I agree with seeing what the CCCP has done. And those things, the amount of things that were collected in those pavilions has been sustaining an ongoing work of education and projects that have been going on all summer. So Kuhlhaus, and I've thought this before, I hope it doesn't sound unfair, but Kuhlhaus's structure seems to me to open many doors without even necessarily occupying some of the most interesting territory on the other side of that door. I don't mean that in any critical way, but this Biennale's historical conversation, while not reconciling, is maybe most importantly something substantial against which to push into yet more interesting territory, challenging territory. And that territory is not a post-national world, but a world in which nations are only somewhat more obdurate lumps in the lumpy, striated medium of extra-state players, a medium in which the state and extra-state now partner to pursue even more insidious and less traceable deals. So one can imagine something about this Biennale allows one to imagine yet another curatorial adventure for the next Biennales that might release yet more information by further altering structure or disposition, to recognize a world of imbricated, overlapping, contradictory sovereignties, sort of a Biennale of Teutas and Melillas and special economic zones with nations occupying or hijacking or poaching the space and time of other nations. And you already see it in Russia already outsourcing its exhibition to a non-national, and one can imagine many other kinds of continental islands. In Venice a couple of weeks ago when I was there, again, as part of these kind of ongoing conversations that are going on there. Anyway, someone said that the Swiss pavilion had to go all the way to the embassy level to get permission to store some chairs next door in the Venezuela pavilion. And I take that to be, that little banal fact to be the germ of potentially interesting curatorial idea. In the current structure, architects can really only clearly see our modes of practice straining to operate effectively in global networks. But maybe, within a more atomized and lumpy set of players, the architect might manifest their own powers as an entrepreneurial player outside their fee-for-service habits, especially since the single most important thing that our discipline might rehearse, in addition to designing things, is designing an interplay between things. Thank you.
Okay, we'll begin with the usual disclaimers. One, I'm an outlier to this discourse. Two, I can't remember what I did last weekend, let alone what I saw in June. So I'll be basic, not to say obvious, but I will also be brief. I had just two thoughts, one to do with fundamentals and the other to do with absorbing modernity, and they both reflect on Cool House. Obviously, this is an old modernist impulse to return to elements or fundamentals. I think Barry is right. We should talk about the ambiguity between these terms. And I took it to be, on the part of Cool House, not only ironic. I mean, certainly it was ironic, but it was not only ironic. I took it to be auto-deconstructive in this sense, that the examples showed how ridiculous it was in this point in time to search for anything like fundamentals or elements when it comes to floors, walls, ceilings, and the rest. It was like Semper on drugs, you know, like a schizo-Semperian performance. And I think this was a conscious posture in the Cool House mind, and I think there's more than one figure in that mind, obviously. So that's mini thought one. Mini thought two is to do with absorbing modernity. And I think there is a master narrative there, not just micro stories. And I think it was conscious too. And I think it's actually, again, quite personal, even though, again, when I say Cool House, I don't mean one subject. It's like a hive mind that may include many of us. And it would go like this, put it very schematically. If the exhibition looked back over 100 years, it suggested to me anyway that modern architecture one was developed out of war, capitalist transformation, and reconstruction. Same with modern architecture too. In the next war, capitalist crisis, and reconstruction. And I think there's a third modern architecture that Cool House road to great acclaim. And that is not post-war so much as post-wall. But the post-wall looks very much like post-war, I would submit, in the present. Which is to say, what we thought was, or some of us thought, was the new Europe, the new world order, turned out to be a rather atavistic form of capitalism called neoliberalism and emergency, state of emergency. I mean, obviously, this didn't all happen in 1989, but by the point of 2001, with the full triumph of neoliberalism, you add the war on terror, and you get the state of emergency. And I think Cool House wrote that third moment of modern architecture, and I think he was fairly explicit about it, again, to great success, great acclaim. And he developed a whole set of theorems, even theories, to support this architectural boom. He wasn't the only one to benefit from it, of course. It's out of this moment that comes not only SML, XL, but text within it, like the generic city, bigness. He wanted to surf this wave, as I think any architect with any gusto does, given the historical possibilities presented to him or her. But right around 2002, I mean, I can't date it precisely. Maybe it even goes back to the project on the city when it begins to work. Again, the Cool House hive mind begins to work on the project on the city, on shopping, Pearl River Delta, on this new formation called market Leninism, which is perhaps the purest form of neoliberalism, what neoliberals, you know, see as an ideal. That's when all faith in this third version of modernity collapses. And it turns out, Cool House discovers that not even Cool House can surf junk space. And I read the exhibition, you know, in this way, as a kind of retelling of the grand narrative of modernity with a twist around the third moment, which is perhaps now a fourth moment, in which rather than the dandyish Baudelairean figure of ambivalence about modernity, he becomes, you know, fairly conventional, still quite brilliant critic of modernity. And I think that's about all I have to say.
Hi, thank you so much for having me. Thank you, Felicity, for the invitation. You know, having been asked to reflect on one of the probably the biggest events as an architecture curator, you know, this is kind of the main... Oh, my God. Am I touching? Okay. You know, I sort of thought that probably the best thing to do was choose one thing, which I chose as this Wolfgang Tillmann's book for architects, which was... inside the Elements exhibition, right at the end, kind of my last kind of moment of reflection within that kind of ginormous, expansive, ambitious, complicated show, which I kind of went through that experience of going through Elements with James Westcott, who's spoken to you all here, and I was left with this real question, which probably we'll talk about, which is like, is this about the kind of emasculation of architecture? You know, are architects going to go through this and just think, what's the point of us anymore? And, you know, everything that we do is now subcontracted. Like, are we powerless? There's no narrative. There's no politics. There's nothing. There's just the fact that we allow someone else to make our windows for us and our walls are not thick enough anymore and we have no substance to our practice. And then I sort of found this And I was thinking, I hope that's not the case. I don't think it is. But this is, I sort of came across this piece by Tillmans, which is like, I think it's like 45 minutes worth of photographs of architecture that he just snapped essentially on his travels. And it was so beautiful and so moving, and to me summarized the kind of the cool house kind of premise of architecture, not architects, and the real power and beauty of doing an exhibition, an architecture exhibition, not an exhibition of friends and of, you know, family, essentially, if you're talking about architecture schools and architecture family trees, which all of us are sort of part of. And I found it very relevant and very beautiful the way that Tillmans just found architecture in the city, in the countryside. He's found it appropriated, he's found it designed, he's found it abandoned, he's found it colored in and painted and broken and loved. And I just sort of saw something, I suppose, in this work that was also about elements, and that was also about the kind of the way of representing architecture in a way that allowed the architects to be seen and not heard, which I sort of kind of thought was a little bit of Kuhlhaus's point, but of course that he had to be heard very much. And yet, you know, there's also something very generous about the concept, not only to the architecture profession, which allows us all to reflect, and an entire summer worth of reflection, God knows how many articles, you know, goodness knows how many panel discussions from this year on and forward. And I suppose that my kind of interest was not only in, I think, the idea of the kind of, whether it was an emasculation of architecture, and conversely a total fetishization of the practice of architecture, both versions of that story I found within Elements, but also, you know, as a curator, walking through the show and walking through the Giardini, and the way that the, you know, as everybody has discussed before, the way that absorbing modernity absorbed the Giardini and transformed the Giardini into an exhibition space where you first read, as Barry described, you know, you read the pavilions and then you read the content of the pavilions and you read the landscape of the Giardini as part of the story and the narrative of the exhibition, and Venice itself and so on. And also the Mondo Italia, which allowed architects to be architects and architects to do what many young architects do, which is research and practice, and practice in ways that isn't related to building, and practice in ways that is relevant to them and seems important to them and profound to them. And that was also an act of generosity towards Italy and towards the young practices that are working in very sort of strange and weird scenarios in that country, in that complicated country. So yeah, just this kind of leaving you with this whatever kind of roof detail of some place that Wolfgang Tillmans noticed, a sort of ceiling rather, but just to sort of start the conversation on that note. And thank you very much for having me and looking forward to discussing.
Good evening. I probably will run the risk to repeat some of the things that have been just said. Thank you very much for the invitation. It's obviously an honor to speak about this work. Given the fact that so much has been written, so much has been said, and so much has been discussed, I'd like to maybe bring the discussion and my talk on the format that we sort of adopted for this Biennale. And this is it. Yeah. No. No. Yeah. So the exhibition, its entirety, is an experiment on the typical Biennale format. In each one of the three components, we tried something new. In the central pavilion, instead of loosely curating multiple participants in every room, we decided to produce an entire exhibition based on original research about the fundamental elements of architecture, collaborating not with architectural offices, but with historians and industry practitioners.
For the national pavilions, we propose a unified theme, absorbing modernity, that also resonates with the notion of nationality that the pavilions embody. And we devoted the Arsenale to Mondo Italia, an interdisciplinary study and representation of a single country through the mobilization, as just explained, and coordination of other Venice Biennales, so the music, the dance, the theater, and the film, along with multiple researchers. Elements of architecture in the central pavilion shows architecture as a product of the real, the outcome of the vast collection of norms, obligations, economic, social, political, and technological forces that shape its materialization and collective use. The show, as you know, is in first place a book turned into an exhibition, and that systematically emerges in the show space in different forms and through a stream of information, photographs, archival materials, data, interviews, films, a sort of deluge of reality that in the end, we hoped, would together produce an uncanny exhilaration. So here you see some pictures of the toilet room with extracts of the book. You see it here. The deluge of reality. Our intention was not to display research, but to stage it in a simpler version, in its simpler version as image, in the most ambitious version as three-dimensional scenography. So while, of course, the staircase would showcase an archive, the ceiling room was probably the most scenographic of the rooms. But in a way that in the central pavilion, research became, in a way, for us, the main medium of expression, to the point that the visitor's immersive experience in this room is particularly evident, is at times deliberately predominant to the communication of information. Obviously, this is functional to the communication of the message, and for those who know, of course, our previous work, it's a common practice for in OMA exhibitions, if you think about Image of Europe or Chrono Chaos, for example. In Mondo Italia, the attitude is frankly the same, but with more components and languages. Here, the identification with the theatrical dimension is explicit. The exhibition has been conceived more like a master plan in order to mediate and organize the contribution through space and times of all disciplines involved, architecture and cinema as permanent components, dance theater and music as temporary ones. Practically and architecturally speaking, the show combines a complex set of layers, mostly bidimensional, woven into a framework that incorporates nation, geography, place, politics, data, social criteria, metamorphosis, myth, and religion through different media. The geographical metaphor represented by the tabula peruntigeriana becomes in the corderie the main vehicle of organization of those layers, reminding of the importance of surroundings for Italian culture through the geographical complementarity of films and exhibits, where obviously the movies that have been mobilized for this exhibition were deliberately mostly movies about the representation of specific contexts, and where Italian cinematography is obviously very regional and therefore really adaptable to this kind of geographical organization of the exhibition. The two-dimensionality of the movies, the films, and the exhibit is just exposed with the three-dimensionality of the performance spaces. The stage work has conceptual exceptions to the system of parallel scans. When not in use, they act as viewing devices, unlocking multiple views of the show, and simply celebrating the architecture of the corderie. So through time, of course, we were not able to use at any day, at any hour, the stages, but they were used by the audience, which were part of an overall choreography. When in use, they function as spaces for artistic and political engagement, turning the show temporarily into a social stage or a social factory, to use the terminology quoted in the generous contribution to the show by our host, Felicity and Mark. So here you see some of the things that are happening through the exhibition right now, actually. It is difficult to define Mondo Italia exhibition. It is rather, as it's been said many times, a giant ideal set. At the corderie, the theatrical spectacle emerges from the combination of all its layers, whether fully scripted, as in the case of movies and research, or unexpected, as in the case of the performances, with everything else. 5 months after the opening, the result is close to what we described in our original intention as a multidisciplinary work in progress in constant evolution and permanent display, a place where contents and the physicality of the space are renegotiated and reformulated through times, more similar to everyday life than a museum space. To conclude, in different forms, both Elements and Munditalia, in terms of formats, so I'm not basically entering into the content aspect of it, both exhibitions mark the transition from gallery to stage, engaging visitors to be an active part of a gigantic performance. In Elements, the viewer, while being immersed in the continuous flow of content, performs the contemporary motions of information access, scanning, browsing, or playing, like in this case. In Munditalia, the audience is invited to perform the same actions, but not at the scale of the single exhibit, but at the scale of the entire space, while moving three-dimensionally and becoming part of an overall choreography. Format was fundamental in our process, or one of the fundamentals of our process. We knew what we wanted to do in terms of format, where content, message, ideology were never things we wanted to impose. And I leave with this reflection.
So do we need the lights up? And we're going to invite the panelists to the actual panel now. It's actually initially our ambition to have them speak from the table, but then we had image questions. So if everyone can join us.
So this should be easy. Your speakers should just automatically have a lot to say to each other. The Biennale is a door that was opened that we have not really gone through yet. It's potentially something that a spectacle, whether self-consciously or not, it may or may not add up to anything, and it may be the sly embodiment of a critique of a third post-wall modern architecture. So while people are gathering their thoughts, I just want to extract a couple of provocations from the Biennale text written by director Kuhlhaus. And this will be familiar because I think our speakers have already touched on much of what I'm going to draw out. But in relationship to the Elements section, Rem argues that no architect in their right mind would ever propose today to write an Elements of Architecture that intended to explain what the components of architecture are and how they should be put together. So one obvious implication is that fundamentals does not make this proposition, or that the exhibition as a form or something about the form of this Biennale is saved from the hubris that such a book would necessarily embody, which is to say that the exhibition as a demonstration of elements is saved, or further that this is a Biennale that is not in its right mind, which is to say, it, following Barry, it may not add up. But Kuhlhaus offers a suggestion that, as we've heard, that in this Biennale, whatever the dangers of declaring the elements and the fundamentals, these are skirted by compiling the elements as fragments, and rather than relying on clearly bankrupt large histories, which he points to quite specifically, the show and its arguments are composed of and its objects and its pavilions and its exhibitions are composed of micro histories or multiple histories. Yet I think, as Hal has already reminded us, he continues to argue that these disjunctive fragments also fall under an overarching historical shift. Not only that of neoliberalism, which he's quite explicit about, but he also claims that in this text, in the Elements of Architecture pamphlet, that those elements that you would have to be insane to write about, that were once mute, now record and collect a vast amount of information about us. And he says that when one hears the word intelligent building or smart house, one should reach for the barrel of your mouse. Because these buildings and those terms and the architecture they represent now have the capacity to betray us. And as a result, architecture potentially falls prey to another form of authoritarianism. So the first question I have is, even though we've heard really brilliant and provocative readings of the Biennale in general, if this is true, if in part of what is at stake in this project is to refuse what an insane declaration of the elements of architecture would be, and to offer some other reading of a compilation of histories through elements and counter-fundamentals, let's say, and if it's the task of this Biennale then to not remain mute, but to expose and speak back to those mechanisms that Rem claims are already communicating so insidiously through these elements that record and track us, just to pick on one of his examples, where would we locate this? Where do you, as readers of this Biennale, locate the Biennale as a mechanism that speaks back? What is it speaking back to? And how would we do that, not in the general text, but in specific analysis of the pavilions, the exhibition elements, the organization into its three component parts? What is it speaking back to if we are refusing this insidious new phase of intelligent smart buildings, just to choose one example? Because he also, as I think has been pointed out, declares the project in general intends to speak back. It intends to speak back to Portuguese, and it intends to speak back to a history of biennales and their failed or limited propositions. And in particular, he claims that it intends to speak back to the authority through which those biennales, especially the 1980 Biennale, attempted to claim or to demonstrate or to embody or to sponsor a set of traditional values for architecture. And so if it's speaking back to those claims, where do we locate its counterpropositions? Where do we locate something like evidence of an architecture that would refuse those traditional values? So this is a question just to ask everyone, maybe to tighten up their analysis by finding particular moments within the Biennale that we can attach these claims to, or that we can test those claims against.
I could offer a little bit of information. I can tell you, when working on the elements portion, I can tell you what I thought I was working on, which was something that was anti-encyclopedic, that was absolutely not about sort of hoarding a lot of information, but was kind of a long reflection, and I was allowed to write an essay that was sort of based on William Gass's On Being Blue. It was kind of like on floor, turning around this floor, mostly not to again to hoard or collect information, but to return to fatal errors, to return to very few artifacts, where one could see the bombast of the discipline ossifying an element, and then finding those reasons why there was a kind of wilder element on the other side of that, what was ossified. So in what I was looking at was the floor that is escaped the floor of the non-modern man, in a way. So I was surprised when I, and it's a question I have for the CCCP. How does one do an exhibition when 3/4 of the actual effort has been in writing a very careful essay with a very particular relationship where you're wrapping yourself around a reader for a cadenced period of time, and that's the work, and then when the book is made into an exhibition, that's a very different thing, you know. And the book's, you know, weighed 15 pounds and cost 120 euros, which no one would carry in the heat. And I'm positive that no one in this room has read the essay that I wrote. That was all of the work of that. So how do you reconcile those two things with an exhibition that looked like very encyclopedic hoarding of information at times? You know, it did not look like this kind of careful return to contemplative moments of failure and possible redefinition.
Anyone else?
I can only share your what you've just offered, which is perplexing. So just to take one room, you know, to go into the windows room, now I spent more time there because the guy who assembled those windows was there. And he heard my accent and he said, oh, you're American. He said, you wouldn't know where I could get a sort of 1840 sash window approximately of this size. That's sort of missing in my collection. But as I was having this discussion with him, I thought, why are these windows here? You know, we're confused. Do we love these windows? Are we meant to have nostalgia for these windows while this machine is making something generic? Or are they, you know, so they're very confusing emotions in this, in this show. And sometimes you feel like in the process of it, these windows were discovered. It was just too good. They had to be in the room as well, but it was a very confusing message. Were we supposed to be savoring the typology of difference, or not?
Sorry, just to, I don't want to continue quickly, but so, I mean, even that reflection on the window would seem to put some pressure on your typology of three exhibition paradigms that came from art, yeah? The installation, the ring, the archive, the capacity, and the relational aesthetics. I mean, even that type of, let's say, not in confusion in a bad way, but the difficulty to situate a gesture like that seemed to mark one of these moments where the exhibition doesn't translate very well from the book potentially, but also puts a lot of pressure on this this figure of making new objects speak again. Yeah, I mean, so I think this coming back to Hal's remark about the impossibility of surfing, about these sort of moments when the exhibition doesn't resolve easily, yeah, produces these sort of openings that could be read as failures or could be read as, you know, forms of masculation or forms of challenge that keep the exhibition as project really open, yeah? I mean, I think these are, in some ways, the most challenging parts of that exhibition, the difficulty of understanding, you know, why would they do that? Yeah, I mean, that.
Give us some examples. Is the windows moment an example for you?
The windows didn't seem, no.
No, but so give us an example.
The balcony room in the element seemed exactly a moment where it was very difficult to understand for me what went into that space and demanded that you began to unpack it, you know, to produce the type of analysis of an exhibition that one wouldn't normally be prompted to do because there would be familiar gesture, or you would, let's say, analyze an exhibition on a slightly different register than that required of you. I mean, that was my, over and over, a type of slight, slight disarming of one's position as a spectator at an exhibition in terms of how you would normally produce readings and viewing practices. And I don't know.
What, that something, I think there is, by walking through the exhibition, it is clear what has been, let's say, developed through the office, so through the actual direct engagement into the exhibition design and making of the office, and what instead has been somehow fully outsourced. And the balcony was fully outsourced. Mm-hmm. The facade was fully outsourced. clearly. And while the rooms actually curated directly and developed directly by the office, I think they show, of course, this kind of opposition between, of course, past and present, whatever we can get from the past and then re-inject into the present somehow. Very, very clearly, like the ramp was opposing two completely different systems. There was a beautiful picture in that room about the status of ramps of Oscar Niemeyer in Brasilia between the 1960s and today. The ceiling was, of course, very powerfully talking to the same language. Corridor as well, facade as well. So I think in that sense, all the rooms which were showing in a sort of very oppositional manner, you know, this kind of relationship, open up this discussion towards basically how to deal with this kind of transformations. The most generic critique that we received on the exhibition is obviously what architects think about these elements. You know, like that's obviously what we sort of received in terms of criticism, like why talking about, you know, the impoverishment of elements when the actual exceptional architectural practice is actually very much aware. While, of course, our point was is that we were looking to generically the built environment. That's the kind of, and how architects can actually relate to the generically built environment as opposed to exceptional pieces of architecture. Industry was the main focus in itself.
I think Keller's provocation too, maybe as to the way in which the absorbing modernity part of the exhibition pushed to the limit, the, you know, the very feasibility of something like a national pavilion. I think, but I think this had a similar type of slightly disorienting question. On the one hand, you know, it seems simply to be product of the sort of centralized coordination of, you know, part of Biennale that would not normally be centralized. On the other hand, yeah, it opened up the sort of implied failure of the very structure of the Biennale. I mean, I think there were many moments like this that were really super provocative. And I really like the question you raised about, you know, how, and I, you know, each director is faced with this question, but how to come after the 14th Architecture Biennale, you know, what exactly sort of demands of the next curator, yeah, in terms of how to proceed or, you know, how to react against. I mean, maybe this is another way of coming back to Mark's question about how to speak as an architectural exhibition after a project that has tested so many of these limits.
Let's say one thing. You know, for all the talk of how this exhibition was outsourced, it struck me as still very authored. You know, I don't think if you compare it to an art biennale that any curator would have the authority to guide the national pavilions to stick to a subject, to a question. I mean, that just never happens. So on the one hand, it's completely unauthored, outsourced, wiki research. I love this term that I first heard from Barry. but also, you know, quite singular as a position. And I think the real question is the subject effect, the viewer effect. And this is what I would like to discuss, or like people to discuss. This idea that Barry brought up, that the historian is not needed, that there is no coherent subject effect, subject position for the viewer of this exhibition, or indeed any exhibition like it. Perhaps we're at a point now where you can't simply download information anymore and call it a show. I mean, I'm happy that you use the term archival, and there was a tendency in art practice over the last generation that I actually called the archival impulse. But there it was driven by a desire for a quite specific kind of counter memory, where marginal loss materials were reassembled, often in a kooky way. But it wasn't just a whole lot of data. And I just don't, you know, I think this is a general curse now in exhibitions. And this may be one bad effect of the art transfer to architecture. I mean, just one other comment about the art architecture. You know, I was very interested in your tropes. You know, when I published this book, Art, the Art Architecture Complex, I was accused of the following, that I treated architecture as a bad object. And now we have art treated as the bad object in architectural circles. And certainly this is what Sylvia Laban did in her review for Art Forum. And it's a bit what you did, Barry, just now. And I wonder, not that I'm here to defend the art quotient, but I want to get back to your provocation that the historian is not needed, and my extrapolation from this proposal that there is no coherent knowledge to be gained from such exhibitions formatted thusly. Can you say more?
Yeah, well, I want to say more building on what you said, which I think has caused some interesting reflection, because I thought when you isolated this post-wall moment, and then this has been reinforced by discussing the contrast between the now and the then that's offered at the extreme ends of the historical comparison. Actually, the dome even predates the 1914, it's probably 1890-something. I thought more and more, but that actually is not what the National Pavilions did at all. Almost all of them were interested in an earlier moment in modernism. There was very, very little on display that actually dated from post-89 in any of the pavilions. Mm-hmm. So I actually think there were lots of micro-histories, but then they all came with their own issues of what was the relationship of modernity to nationality, what was the relationship, how could this be used to narrate something in a, you know, to deal with post-traumatic situation of what may have happened in 89, but there was very little direct confrontation between the present and whatever past was being researched, in whatever form. So as you were saying that, I was thinking, that is interesting. If that may be a overt agenda, but to me, just wandering around the grounds, it felt like a rather well hidden agenda.
Well, maybe it's a projected agenda on my part. But what I meant is that this third moment of modernity has so soured that, you know, post 1989 moment has so soured that it's made other moments of modernity, other moments of modernization, seem catastrophic too. And that's what some of the pavilions picked up. There wasn't much hope in any of the other phases of modernity, it seemed to me, as national pavilions reflected on the encounter of modernization and nation. But, you know, you see what you want to see, what you want to believe.
I don't know. I'll just say, for the British Pavilion, I remember feeling quite disappointed, and in general, something that I noticed across all the pavilions was that whilst the pavilions were sort of uniquely repetitive in their analysis of the relationship between modernity and the present day, all of them with the endless timelines, but they were also I felt a little down that they were so unproductive, or there was so little kind of sort of propositional work and so much history. And even though the British Pavilion, which I loved for its Cliff Richard album Dad listening moments history. And so on, I was left with the feeling of like, where's our Ebenezer Howard of today, and where's, who's writing garden cities of tomorrow, where, like, who, you know, are we going to find that in this Biennale, or are we going to find that in the next Biennale? Mm-hmm. And I guess I found that the whole show was a kind of palate cleanser in a way, and I'm kind of, I felt like it was a, yeah, like a moment of real kind of washing the slate, and now can someone come up with something better? I hope, maybe, I don't know.
Should we open it up?
Yeah. Yeah.
Mark, I'm going to leave that to you, so
we'll stop. Sure. Well, lots of questions, but one quick one just about research, the term research, mostly for Ippolito, but also for Barry and everyone else. I think it's interesting to me that has been one of the more controversial terms in critiques of the Biennale. And, you know, when I think of research, I think of something that's above all curated, but I also think of analysis and possibly even conclusions. And I think, in a way, I was almost taken aback, but perhaps refreshed to hear how frank you were about that really not being the goal, particularly this distinction between display and staging. So what I'm wondering is why you even hang on to the term research, and what's at stake in, you know, OMA at all really claiming that term, and whether for people like Barry, it would be more productive to in fact jettison that and just call it information and data and sort of completely shift the term on stage.
Okay. So, for OMA, to be frank, I think that we never really claimed the terms research until, for this Biennale, until the president of the Biennale claimed actually the terminology for us. And somehow we were struck into the process of following him. I think there is of course a difference between the exhibition itself and the research, at least in the case of elements. That's, of course, the book is not the exhibition is part of the book. In general, I do agree, of course, that a lot of what has been defined as research has just been like a conglomerate of data and so on, although in this generic conglomerate of data and infographics, I think they were like quite interesting discoveries, at least for me, in terms of specific pavilions, for example. I was struck by the story shown by the Chilean pavilion. I think one of the most probably sensitive in terms of hinting the topic that we launched. I don't have really an answer in terms of claiming the terminology or not. I think that's always the risk, in a way. That's why I wanted also to shift the attention from pure content to the format, because in terms of approach and methodology, speaking about what this Biennale can do for the following Biennales, it is exactly the way we worked on it, more than really immediately, at least, the theoretical legacy that it could leave. I don't think for the moment it's ready to leave any specific theoretical legacy. Maybe it raised some questions, but it raised a possible format to deal with a Biennale that somehow it's, as a format, it's been proliferating around the world quite extensively without necessarily really trying to fully reinvent it. So that's similar in a way, and then maybe going back to OMA, to the way we approach architectural projects. I mean, we sort of try to re-engineer the typology of the Biennale in the same way that sometimes we re-engineer the typology of some architectural design.
Before we go into the next question, I just wonder what term would stand in for research, if it's not research, highly problematic term, one imposed by the Biennale structure. And yet somehow everyone is commenting on how this Biennale distinguishes itself from previous Biennales. And in one of the ways it does that is by not, or slipping its engagement with contemporary design, or slipping its engagement with the injunction to show recent architectural propositions or artifacts. And so if it's not research, I wonder what term our guest critics would use, because it's not an archive. We've already dismissed the archive. It's not just information accumulation. It's something else. And as we also learn from this catalog, this, and as Ippo has told us, this is a book that comes out of 3 years of
not
research?
Not that one, eh?
No, but the previous book, yes, yeah. That comes out of the 3 years, of I'm not sure what to call this term, research with students at the GSD. And so if somehow the Biennale is indicted as a failed research project, it reverberates back to architectural teaching institutions and asks what we mean by research in that mode as well, because it, if nothing else, it's an amplifier of the frailties of that term, let's say. Jean-Louis?
Yes, I wanted to say a couple of things. Yes, well, very flattered to have a microphone. No, I think research has a meaning if you contrast it with the term search. And a lot of what is produced today is more on the search mode than on the research mode. Research is about interpretation, and that's where the Biennale is raising, I'm talking about the Central Pavilion, is raising serious issues. Barry has insisted on the overwhelming presence of timelines, chronologies, etc. And I would be, I would have here be cruel and remind everybody of what Balzac said. He said, reducing the life of an individual to a mere collection of facts is doing chronology, l'histoire des sots, history for stupid people. So I think what is missing is not research, it's historical interpretation. What are the determining factors? How were these elements produced? What do they mean? And I think it was my problem with Central Pavilion is its descriptive character. And so that's one aspect. The other one, which is really interesting, it hasn't been underlined by anyone, but I was struck by the by a sort of rampant paranoia in the pavilion. Devices that are supposedly providing comfort, but that in a way track your movements. Doors that become security gates at the airports. There is a sort of presence of surveillance, repression, observation, which is really striking. And which also was part of the initial agenda of absorbing modernity. It's true, Hal is right, that this Biennale was extremely offered. I wouldn't say authoritarian, it was negotiated, and there were some pavilions who simply ignored completely the request by REM. Others painstakingly tried to implement them, some with much imagination. I agree with the Chilean pavilion. But I think my analogy is a very superficial one. Usually the Biennale is like a zoo in which every country shows a particular animal in its cage. This time, REM had a more choral perspective, trying to have everybody more or less sing to the same key, two different themes, but in a more harmonious way. And it worked sometimes. I think there it worked in many ways. But also in response to a rather paranoid question, absorbing modernity, if you read the initial spec by REM, was about absorbing American modernity. American modernity and other modernities, the one produced by the Eastern Bloc in the 50s and 60s was ignored, with one exception, the Chilean talking about the Soviet-inspired and Soviet-exported panels, which were in fact French, because the Soviet patents were French patents, which had been bought in the 50s. So I think that this the modernity which was meant to be absorbed was seen in a very sectarian way, reduced to a small number of building types and technologies. So in fact, for me, the real missing attitude is the historical attitude, and it's too bad for a Biennale which prides itself of being historical.
I completely agree. I was surprised by
a desire for the sort of cliché of the fact book and cliché of the clichés of data gathering and research and hoarding. I just thought there was a tacit understanding that that was already tiresome and that we were tired of that and that we were, and so the word I thought I would offer, you know, the word I thought, what I thought we were going for was not data research, but voice, which is something like what Jean-Louis has just
heard. I think that was what, I would agree with you, Jean-Louis, but my feeling in much of it was looking for the pavilions that I don't need to get rid of research. I just want to be in a state of research that transcends the hunter-gatherer stage.
Yeah.
So, you know, I don't dismiss agriculture either, but I think it's gotten beyond the hunter-gatherer stage.
Do you think voice would only, I mean, just to come, I mean, I think it's a fantastic term, but whose voice would that be? I mean, would it be the voice, you know, of the architect? Would it be the voice, I mean, what? How would you begin to identify that voice and manifest it?
Well, I mean, it's the voice informed by research, but okay. But I mean, it's exactly what Jean-Louis was saying, just another word for a historical interpretation, a contemplation on that information.
It's an authorial voice.
An authorial voice.
I was just going to take up a couple of these points that I think are related, which is about one of which is about authorship and non-authorship, because I think Kohlhaas, both as a curator and over many years as a teacher, has engaged in a kind of slippery realm between these two, and I think it's related to this issue of having a voice, taking a position, so versus presenting data or history as if it were neutral. So very much, I think one of the problems. On the one hand, I wanted to embrace the Biennale for being interested in the past. I felt as a historian, I had to feel like, oh, thank you for that. On the other hand, it seemed like, as I think Barry was already implying, history without historians, in the sense that there was no sense that to bring this information from the past, one also needs a point of view about it. And I felt like, but my what I'm trying to say about authorship versus non-authorship is that also over many years in Kohlhaas's publications with the GSD students and so forth, there's this sense of, well, you know, he's all controlling, and yet where is he? What is he actually, where's the voice of the author in these multiple and profuse publications? And I think similarly, there was a kind of slipperiness in the Biennale in which, yes, he has asserted a level of control and coherence heretofore never seen. On the other hand, what did he think about this information that he was presenting, and what were we meant to think of it? I think this is really just echoing points that have now been made, but I think it's quite problematic because of the way that it does reiterate in architecture schools, or become echoed in architecture schools across the globe, to say that it's possible to have an archive without an archivist, that you can have history without historians, that you can present this information or in any form, and that the information might be neutral.
You ask if the voice was a critical voice, right? And there was a moment when, thank you for the presentations. I came here to actually understand perhaps what I am still trying to understand. And perhaps we are all trying to understand something that I think this Biennale has done very differently, is to start questioning with which voice are we not only speaking, but we are also looking. And that has to do when, if Monditalia transforms the visitor into a performer, if the installation in the floor makes us not only look into the floor, but start questioning and wondering who we are, The question is, how strong is that question and how directed that question is? And for me, it was perhaps, I wouldn't say frustrating, but to try to figure out what were the conversations I was missing during the opening week and during the weeks after that I should have been part of, but I was not part of because I was busy with some other things. And the lack of focus of what is the conversation that we are actually having is perhaps just the reflection in the conversation where architecture really trying to reduce itself to some notion of fundamentals that starts through the elements needs to start having. I always fantasize that the toilets would have Slavoj Žižek guiding us through from one toilet to the next, but he never appeared. I expected that the political would come in a much more strong manner through each one of those elements that were put in front of us to remind us that the architectural act and voice occurs in any single element. Yet, for me, the larger question, and this is maybe one that has to do with the format of the Biennale, what is the function of a Biennale today when, in fact, for me, it's not a place where we go to see it. It is not for us to listen to it or to find it or to realize that it's an archive or not. But it is an opportunity to actually start something that is totally else, that it is not a book, that it is not an exhibition, that it is a phenomenon in and of itself that the Venice Biennale in particular embodies. And so the question to me is, what did OMA, AMO, REM, anyone of the national pavilions started in the Biennale that is going to continue either as a discourse or as a project? And this is something maybe, Ippolito, that you can respond. Where is elements going?
There are several, I think, layers. Several layers of different kind of afterlives, I think, to this project. Elements, I think, had a sort of technological discoveries, for example, came through the process quite at the end. In a way, although they were, of course, very present in the exhibition and in the book, somehow they were part of the last kind of evolution of the research. So if there is an evolution in terms of research, that is definitely it, in a way. Like I said, for me, and then I'm talking about myself and not OMA or AMO, I really agree with you in terms of what is the sense of a Biennale today. Are we doing it for us? Are we doing it for other people who are actually approaching architecture? There's been, I think, comments which were really relevant about making architecture more accessible, even by just using space or just using exhibits. I think that was, in a way, definitely part of the intention to simply enlarge as much as possible the audience. We definitely didn't reach that goal, but it was part of our discussions, especially when we were actually placing together all the pieces of the research turned into an exhibition, so to say, or by mobilizing the other departments of the Biennales. And I go back to my comment from before. To me, this was an interesting exercise to understand how the Biennale itself can work, whether you can establish hybrid domains, whether you can establish basically not necessarily like for the national pavilions, whether you can establish, for example, the possibility of neglecting the next Biennale, the fact that France is in the French pavilion, or, you know, like, and so on. It's a question of how to structure the work. To go back to this comment about authorship, instead I'd like to maybe refer to something that sometimes it's forgotten, but it for me it's also very relevant, that REM is obviously also the director and the main person of a 400 people office. So he acts and directs also in theory more or less with the same attitude. Especially when it deals with somehow the construction of research and dealing with a lot of people working with it. So it is different, I think, that it cannot be evaluated solely from, you know, like the point of view of a curator, or like REM is not necessarily a curator per se. It's been somehow managing or being a curatorial manager in a way of the whole exhibition. So the fact of being present very much in front, up in front, or being a little bit behind the scenes, or as Sylvia Levin, for example, made a kind of an interesting connection to the work of Harold Zeman, of course. It's two completely different attitudes. While Harold Zeman was involved in every single exhibit, very specifically coordinating with every single artist and with the spaces between every single artist, Bram somehow managed the process creatively and intelligently, but without, of course, having this kind of full presence on every single detail. So if I don't know whether that can actually answer the question of authorship or not, but it's mostly a question of structuring guidelines. And that's what the Biennale did. It structured guidelines, then leaving a margin of freedom of how to respond to these guidelines.
Yes, I think one more thing really quickly. I mean, the architects were displeased because they were excluded, and now the historians are displeased because they are excluded. So maybe the effect, Eva, will be that it has cleared the ground a little bit. And maybe Beatrice will get her wish that the next version will have space to operate in. I mean, I think it was actually terrific that the pavilions weren't filled with the latest bauble by the grooviest architect from that particular country. For the most part, there was a little bit of that. It was a huge relief to have an exhibition free of that kind of, the usual promotionalism. So I think that's a step in the right direction. It concerns me a little bit that the historians want to reclaim hermeneutics, that indeed we want to find again the author, the voice.
I think I
know what you mean, but...
What do you think I mean?
Well, I hope you mean it in the sense of the grain of the voice. It's not necessarily specific.
I don't mean the mouthpiece. That's not what I mean.
Well, what do you mean then?
I mean yes, curatorial, authorial, was the saying something with the coloring, shaping the information.
Taking
that,
responsibility.
Yeah, that kind of voice, not the mouthpiece. That's not what I meant.
So, an architecture exhibition without architects, architectural history with out architectural historians, and as we've learned from Ippo, a curated biennale in which there is no curator because the curator is a manager. So I believe that's the future of the biennale. Thanks very much.